My name is Aditya Godbole. I work at Vertis Microsystems as the CTO. And okay, so before we start, a set of disclaimers. I am a Haskell fan, obviously, but my interest is purely academic. I mean, I don't expect to use Haskell in production, at least in my company, anytime soon. But at the same time, there's a lot to learn from Haskell, even if you don't end up using Haskell in your production work. I am in no ways a Haskell expert. So if you say something like monads are monoids in the category of endofunctors or something like that, I'll have no idea what you're talking about. Okay. This is an experience report based on an interesting course we took internally in our organization. So there's a context associated with this talk, and needless to say, this talk will be quite opinionated. And things that are true in this context may not necessarily apply to the context that you are in. So please make your own opinions about anything that I say. Having said that, it's important to state the context. So we are basically a services company, and we do outsource product development and product management. And most of our developers are hired locally from colleges in and around Pune. We use Ruby, JavaScript, Python, Java, Go among the popular or the more used languages. So the question really is, why Haskell? And to begin with, why functional programming at all? I mean, I know this sounds a bit weird speaking at a functional conference, but there has to be a reason to do something to invest your time and effort in, right? So far, like, the mainstream paradigm has been object-oriented, and we have got some pretty cool purely functional object-oriented languages like Ruby. And so why suddenly look at functional programming to begin with? So one of the things that I do as part of my job is code reviews. And often the code is good according to functional, according to object-oriented principles and all that, but I often find that there's something missing. Something that there's a difference between code that works and code that's beautiful, okay? And that sort of pinches me now and then. And through my experience, I've realized that at the end of the day, it is beautiful code that will scale, and that will be more maintainable. So our inherent sense of beauty comes from something functional, okay? So why not OO? I mean, this big question mark and question that have been asked to me quite a few times. What's wrong with OO? So before that, we really need to see what we mean by OO, or object-oriented, and what we mean by functional. Okay, because there's a wide range, like Scala is functional, GRUE is functional, Haskell is functional. So what exactly do we mean by functional, and what exactly do we mean by OO? So firstly, in my experience, the traditional object-oriented model really works at the macro scale. And when I say macro scale, I mean one interface being worked on by multiple developers. That's the large scale. So what exactly do we mean by OO? So what I mean is you have these opaque objects, and these opaque objects communicate with each other through predefined controlled windows. So it's like there's a black box, and there's some guy sitting at, or multiple people sitting at windows, and there's a windows which allow you to access things inside that opaque object, and you go to that person, tell him, hey, I want this, or please do something. He does something, churns some machinery internally, and comes back and gives you some answer. Okay, that's the ideal object-oriented world, where everything is controlled through these windows, and a set of, or a contract of these windows, is basically what you call an interface. The important thing over here is the data exchange, which I have shown by green circles, ideally should be pure data, right? Simple data that you can inspect, not opaque, but completely transparent. In such a system, things work really well at the macro scale. I mean, we have all talked about service-oriented architecture, right? That's nothing but a specialized case of object-oriented architecture like this, where each of these squares are just singletons, in a way, right? The problem that I have encountered is we tend to do this, right? So we tend to make everything an object, and that starts creating problems. So even the messages that we pass among our objects end up being objects themselves. And then you get into all the problems of mocking and blah, blah, blah. So to me, good OO is characterized by three things: opaque objects, controlled interaction, and well-defined interfaces. Okay, so those are the desirable characteristics of object-oriented code. But when you start looking inside these objects, right, we come to the micro level. And that is basically where one developer is working with multiple interfaces. That's where things sort of start to get ugly, when you try to impose the same object-oriented principles. So what is it that you want from the code, or what are the desirable characteristics of the code at this level? So firstly, you want to be working with data, no strings attached, right? You don't want a method on it, getters, setters, blah, nothing. Okay, same simple data. If it's immutable, it's a bonus, but it's really important that the data be completely transparent. There should be no overhead of methods that goes along with that data. The reason is, when you try and get into all the mocking stuff, so the real problem with TDD nowadays is not TDD itself, but that we have to mock functionality instead of mocking data, right? And that becomes really painful. But if you have simple data, I mean, think Python dicts or C structs or tuples, if you're talking Haskell, then it's very simple to simulate these, and it's very simple to reason and test about small pieces of code, which is what a developer is focused on at any given point of time. The second, and I think the defining characteristic of sort of functional code, is atomic operations. Now, when I mean atomic, this has nothing to do with thread safety and all that atomic, okay? So consider a function where you take any newbie programmer and ask him to write a function which takes in two integers and returns the sum of those integers. There's a very less chance that that programmer is going to go wrong in writing that function, right? It's very simple, return A plus B. So why, I mean, if you look what actually happens on the machine, if you consider a standard von Neumann architectures, even if you consider a RISC machine, this is going to boil down to something like a couple of instructions at least, right? But the reason the programmer does not make a mistake in writing a simple addition function is because the compiler has abstracted away the complexity of all those sequence of steps that needs to be done from the programmer, right? The compiler gives you a single operation denoted by one operator plus. That's it. You don't have to worry about what sequence of operation happens, okay? So that, I think, is the defining characteristic of any functional code. So the difference really is not object-oriented versus functional. I think it's declarative versus imperative. In the declarative style, you basically tell what your intent is. You say what needs to be done. Whereas in the imperative style, you give a sequence of steps and you say how that needs to be done, and the intent is implicit. Okay, sometimes if you see large chunks of code, you have to like really scratch your head to figure out what the intent behind this code was. You rarely get that problem with good functional code. Now, the interesting thing is we can sort of do write code like this even in our mainstream languages, right? We can write code. So if you really want to move to functional style, try this trick. Take any piece of code and convert it such that it doesn't have any reassignments. Okay, zero reassignment. to any variables, what you'll be forced to write is a functional style of code. Okay, I've done this exercise, taken any standard piece of code from one of our repositories and just refactored it so that I was not allowed to do any reassignment. So you can assign to a variable once. You can't assign any value to that variable again, or you can't call a mutating method on that variable again. Okay, so why can't we do that in a normal programming practice? Right? We can always make all Java variables final. We can always write code even in Ruby or any other language where we don't modify any variables. So one reason is A, people are not aware that of this style of programming, but B, I think it's really a problem with discipline. Okay, that's what I found. I mean, even if you go and tell programmers, okay, if you use this style of programming, look how nice the code becomes, how readable and maintainable it becomes. If it is possible for them to not do it, there's a high chance that they will not do it. Okay, so this talk is really about how to use Haskell and get yourself or inculcate that discipline in you by practicing in Haskell. Okay, so how do you sort of inculcate this discipline? One very simple, yeah. So, yeah. So, I mean, it will obviously differ from person to person. But I've had cases where somebody came to me with code that they needed help with, and I saw the existing code, and it was like, yeah. So I just refactored it right there in front of them. From like 50 lines, it came down to I would say 10 lines or so, just by using a standard map reduce and all those things. And at the end of it, they were like, wow, I mean, this is so much more maintainable. So they really saw the value in that. But next day again, they wrote the same kind of code, right? So it also needs, A, you need to know what to do, but B, it's really, as you say, it has to come from the tips of your fingers, right, to a certain extent. Sure.
So the point is, academics may teach you, may not teach you. So either the person is convinced this is the right way to write the code, or I believe he is convinced, and conviction will require him to learn and understand.
Someone needs to tell us.
Yeah. But if somebody is not writing this kind of code, I have two choices. Either I can say this guy is not disciplined, and let me discipline him and give him a list of things to do, or I can say this guy is not convinced, I focus on convincing. So my question was, should I focus on disciplining him or should I focus on convincing?
Should we give the fish to the hungry person, or should we tell how to fish? I'm just leaving it here.
Yeah, I think you do need to discipline, like, at least by my experience. They need to be convinced, otherwise to learn anything, you need to be convinced about it, not just functional programming. This goes for anything. But for programming, which is more practice as well, you do need discipline. So I thought about what I could do to sort of get that discipline. And one obvious answer was to put them in a constrained environment. Okay. So when I was a kid, we used to take our inter-society gully cricket matches really seriously. And my brother, he had a problem with short pitch balls. Anytime the ball used to rise above his chest high, he used to close his eyes and do this. Right? And we said, okay, we are losing because of that. We can't this cannot carry on. So in our house, we had a similar corridor, except it was enclosed on both sides. And I started throwing the ball at him from a very short distance, really fast, short pitch stuff. And the rule we made was, you can either leave the ball cleanly, or if you hit it, it has to hit the ground first. It cannot hit any of the walls, right? 10, 15 days of this practice, and he actually got a lot better. Right? Because he didn't have any choice. If the ball hit his bat and hit any of the walls, I started batting and he had to get me out, and he had to bowl till I got out. Right? So, of course, it helps to be an elder brother. So, one option which had really worked for me was SICP. I mean, that's like the classic. You get a very minimal language, according to me, like the best or the most elegant language, just in terms of language design that I have seen. I really recommend, if you have not read that book, please do read it. It's a classic. It changed the way I thought about programming. Okay. So I actually went and experimented with this. We took a self-study session, and in our company itself, we did a couple of chapters from SICP. But it didn't really solve the problem. And in some cases, things actually got worse. So I started thinking what it must be that's missing, right? Till I stumbled upon this quote from this gentleman, which says, bad programmers worry about the code, good programmers worry about data structure and the relationship. And that's when it hit me. That was the answer. Right. The reason why SICP had worked for me was I had spent 7-8 years working in languages like C and C++, where I had no option but to model data in structs, and it was a statically typed language. So I realized that I needed to put these people in a statically typed environment, but also a very constrained environment at the same time. And so this is also reflected in another age-old sentence from another very good book. Fold knowledge into data so that program logic can be stupid and robust. So so I was looking around for such solutions. I had no idea that something called Haskell even existed. But my problem was solved when I met Mr. Modi. Not that Modi, this Modi. He's a lecturer at the University of Pune. And he uses a variant of Haskell for their internal computer science course. Now, Gofer is actually one of the predecessors of Haskell. It was written something in 1990 or something. And it's a very small language. Today, it's a subset of Haskell. But it turned out to be exactly what I wanted. Okay. It's written in C. It has a very small code base. And I can actually understand what that code does. So there were times when I had to go and modify it. The actual implementation itself, like change how some operators behave and all that. It was very easy for me to do it because, I mean, I've done a lot of C. Secondly, it comes with two preludes. So think of a prelude like a standard library, although you can also do things like define precedence of operators and stuff like that in the prelude itself. So PU simple is a prelude that has no type classes. If you don't know what a type class is, doesn't matter. But it is it doesn't have type classes, whereas the standard PUSTD does have type classes. So PU simple will put you in a really constrained, type safe environment, and there's really no escaping it. Okay. Also, like all cool things nowadays, I added a web interface so you can access it in the browser. So one less reason to not use it. So what did we actually do? Now, remember that this is about learning from Haskell, not learning Haskell itself, right? So we concentrated on things that we can take from Haskell and apply to our regular or the other languages like Python, Ruby, JavaScript, etc. So in that sense, it's about the low-hanging fruit of Haskell. And I thought it would be easy, but it definitely was not. So I'll go through some of the steps that we went through. I'm not going to go through all the exercises and stuff that we did. If you have any questions about the code, please stop me and ask. Although if it's something that will take time to explain, we'll have to take it offline after the talk. So we started with very simple functions, like things like, so here's a function which it takes a input as a number limit, and it returns the smallest integer whose square is greater than the input. So for example, if I pass in 10, it is going to return me, if I pass in 100, it is going to return me 11, because 11 square is the smallest square greater than 100. So if I pass in 200, it's going to return me 15, okay? So this is how you would write it in Haskell or Gofer. So you can use where to introduce a inner function. So if you've done JavaScript or Python, you would be familiar with inner functions. These things here, they are called guards. So basically, this allows you to choose what implementation of the function you want based on the condition that you give over here. So what this says is, if y square is greater than limit, then this evaluates to y, and otherwise is actually an alias for true. So otherwise it is iter y plus 1, okay, simple. Now, is this a iterative process or a recursive process? How many say recursive? How many say iterative? So this is actually an iterative process, although it uses function recursion, okay? Because, sorry? Yeah, so this is a tail call. So consider this call of, the second call of iter y plus 1, right? In the call stack, you don't really, what you're doing is you're returning the value returned by this iter directly to the calling function. So you don't need to maintain any state of the calling function after you have called iter y plus 1, right? So if you consider a stack-based implementation, instead of adding to the stack, you can just replace the current stack frame with this new call, right? And the process will finish. It's not, I mean, there's nothing in the calling function that is waiting for the result of this called function, okay? So this is an iterative process, and that's how you do iteration in Haskell. Basically, you use this thing called tail call recursion, and the Haskell compiler is intelligent enough to figure out that, this is a tail call. I don't need to maintain the current stack frame, and it'll replace it. Okay, yeah. I know a few languages which which have tail call optimization of tail call recursion as part of the language spec itself. So one is Scheme, second is Haskell, you have Lua, and maybe I've missed something else. Maybe Erlang. Closure doesn't have, you have to say recur explicitly. I mean, the JVM doesn't support tail call recursion. No, I think the reason Clojure does not have tail call recursion is because it's not implemented in the JVM. Otherwise, they would have any day gone for it. So
isn't there a risk here, because what you're doing is you're using one language to help constrain people to a particular paradigm so that they get better at a different language? But especially with tail call, the difficulty is you don't want to use tail call recursion in other languages, let's say like Python. You actually want them to not use code like this, because it will be terribly expensive in a different environment. So writing code like this to learn would actually require them to immediately unlearn it before they start using something like this in Python.
So I was actually going to cover this in one of the later slides.
In Python, not
right. So. I was going to cover this in one of the later slides, but there are certain aspects of working with this that you have to explicitly mention when you are covering this. You have to explicitly say that this is native only to Haskell and your language does not support it. So then we go into how do you write something similar in your language, okay? So we use this to teach basic iteration versus recursion. And the idea that basically iteration is nothing but carrying the state over multiple function calls, if that's one way to look at it, and which is why you can use it in this way in Haskell. So just some pointless refactoring, just to show that you can do this, basically. Okay. The next thing that we took was the calculation of square root by successive approximation, another thing directly stolen from SICP. So this is Newton's formula that to calculate the square root of any number, you successively keep on calculating better values. So a new better value is the old value plus the number that you want to take the square root of divided by old divided by 2. You can draw the number line and you will see that it converges. So this is again the same implementation. You see, the moment you take away assignment equal to as an assignment, you are forced to refactor it into smaller functions. Okay, this is, you just can't do it any other way. So this is again similar iteration, again refactored, just because we can. Yes. Now, one thing that you get by doing this is you can introduce the concept of closures. Okay, so for someone coming from Java or any other language which doesn't use closures exhaustively, so this EPS, for example, earlier it was passed to the function, but when I took it inside, I can use the EPS from the lexical scope of the outer function. Okay, so this EPS can be used in the inner function itself. Okay, so this is actually more than closure, it's lexical scoping, but if you return good enough as a function itself, then that will become a closure. Okay. So next we move on to something really interesting. So these are the two functions that we wrote, right? Now if you see the iter inner function over here, you see a definite pattern over there. Except for these things, everything else, the structure and all that is the same, right? So can we convert this iter to another function, a generic function to which you can pass in these things that are different? So you definitely can, and this is how it will look, right? So what you have done is, here you had iter had only one argument. Here it has three. The first is what you call the predicate, the test. The second is the function that you want to actually apply. And the third argument was what was there initially, right? So you're passing what was different as an argument, okay? And you get higher order functions, okay? So one trick that I've learned over teaching in the university and other places is especially for concepts which have big popular names like pointers or higher order functions or monads, something like that, it's better to teach the concept first and then teach the name, right? Because people come with a lot of preconceived notions of these big names. So I remember in the when I was teaching simple C programming at the university, I actually taught most of the concepts of pointers by calling them address variables, right, including arithmetic and all that, and people and all the students got it really well, and all this was in 1-2 hour session. And at the end of the session, I said, "Oh, by the way, the rest of the world calls address variables pointers," and they were like, "Oh, wow, we know pointers, that's great." And till then, pointers is something that went in advanced C, right? Typically in the syllabus. So. I'm rewriting square root using the till function. So Haskell comes with its own function called until, so which is why I wrote till, which basically does the same thing. You can check the prelude, and it's very similar. Now, there are two interesting things over here. The first is anonymous functions, right? So the first argument to till is actually a function which returns a bool. It takes one argument and it returns a bool. So this is an anonymous, this is how you write an anonymous function. So this is the parameter x, and this is the body, x square greater than limit, okay? Similarly, the second is also expressed as an anonymous function. The good part is that it reads very naturally. You know, it's an atomic operation, no looping, no modification of variables, no I greater than, nothing. Till good enough epsilon and x, improve x starting with x by 2.0. Okay, it's signaling intent, not how to do it. There's a very interesting thing happening over here. How many of you were in Venkat's Haskell talk in the morning? Okay, so he covered something called as partial application, right? So though pedantically it's sort of a bit different, but Haskell has something called as curring, which means that if you define a function with three parameters, and if you pass it just one parameter, it's not going to complain. Instead, it is going to return you a function which is going to take the remaining two parameters. Okay, that is called curring. So in fact, Haskell, the way to think about it theoretically in Haskell is till is a function which takes the first parameter and returns a function which takes the next parameter, which returns a function which takes the last parameter. So you can pass any number of parameters, obviously less than the arity, but if you pass two parameters, Haskell will return you a function which takes the third parameter and will compute the output. Okay? So this is what we are doing over here. If you remember, good enough took three parameters, epsilon, x, and y. So what we are doing is we are passing just two parameters to it, and Haskell is going to return me a function which takes the third parameter, which is basically what p is. Right? P is expected to take one parameter and evaluate to a bool. Right? Now the beauty of all this is if you make any mistake in this, the type checking system of Haskell is going to scream at you. Right? So remember, so till now we have not talked of types at all. But behind the scenes there is a very elaborate type inference and type checking system which is going to check your types every single step of the way. How many of you, I guess most of you, when in school we did physics, right? So on one hand, we did equations, and on the other hand, we did something called as, I forgot what it's called, basically you do the unit checking, right? Dimensional analysis. So it's very similar to that. If this is your code, which is the actual equation, the dimensions also have to add up. And that's what the Haskell compiler is doing behind the scenes. It is, so think of types as the dimensional equivalent. So then we move to lists. So Venkat covered some of the standard functions which you get on lists in Haskell. So we actually implemented all of those, and they're really simple to implement. Again, some interesting things over here. This colon-colon operator, actually in Haskell it is colon. I've converted it to be colon-colon in Gofer. So the colon-colon operator is used to create a list. So the empty list is predefined. You create a one-element list using this three colon-colon empty list. So this will give you a list containing one element, which is three. You apply the colon-colon operator to that, and you get 2, 3. And you apply one colon colon to that whole thing and you get 1, 2, 3. So list one and list two are identical, okay? this is called a constructor operator. You can have constructor functions as well, which we'll cover a bit later. But this is a constructor operator. It takes two things and returns you a new type, okay? Or it constructs something for you. On the right hand side, this operator works as a constructing operator. On the left-hand side of a equal to, this works as a deconstructing operator. So this is something very new to Haskell, or very different in Haskell. I think ML, it's picked up from ML, but compared to the other languages, it's something very different. So what I'm saying is, the input, if it matches something like x, colon, colon, underscore stands for don't care, but something, right? So which means that this function matches x colon colon anything else, the return value is x, which is exactly what head does to a list. Okay, tail is the first parameter which I don't care about, colon colon the rest of them, the x's. It's going to be deconstructed over here and I return the x's. Okay, last has two definitions, and depending on what pattern matches your input, that particular definition will be chosen at runtime. So what this says is, if I get x colon colon empty list, which means a list with just one element, then I want to return that element. Otherwise, I want to return last of x. This is again an iterative process, a recursive function. Yeah. This compiled, so I guess not. So that's another thing Haskell gives you, right? If it, if the type system does not, so these patterns, so what he's asking is, they were not, are they exhaustive? Do they cover all possible scenarios? So if they don't cover all possible scenarios on the left hand side, the Haskell type system will actually give an error, saying that this is not an exhaustive pattern. Okay, so that is Haskell. In Gofer, that flag is on by default. As an error. Okay. Yeah, probably. I need to check, but I think this code compiles, so it was exhaustive apparently. Yes. No, unless you are going for Scala, I think.
Just a thought I'm having is, if you train the developers into something, into a paradigm, you're giving them more features which are not in the target languages. You're not actually constraining them. What you're doing is giving them more features, giving them more capabilities. Not constraining them like the analogy that you're giving in the cricket part. And then, what these developers are potentially saying is, this is all nice, but I can't anyway implement it if that's my target language, so I'm not going to really worry about this so much. So that the notion about discipline that you talked about may actually be coming from the fact that he's actually doing exercises using enhanced features, enhanced capabilities, which are not available in the target languages. Whereas if you just, as a random pick, focus those exercises, let's say, on using map filter reduce, nothing else, just use map filter reduce, rewrite all your for loops. And the developer does that 3, 4, 5 times. He might actually get convinced, and you don't have to then actually inculcate any discipline him, because he'll see that immediately available and immediately doable. Say, my code is getting so much shorter now, and all my for loops are so much easier and easier to manage and maintain. So constrain it rather than enhance, you know, introduce enhanced capabilities like pattern matching, like net cost recursion, which you can't easily implement into the target language.
Right. So two things about that. One is, so from the code, at least in our organization, I see map reduce and all that being used pretty frequently, relatively. What you're really missing is this, right? The kind of abstractions you can create out of this, this is what was really missing. So map and reduce, as I said, it's the bare minimum. You need to go one level above this. That's what I was really targeting. So that's the first part. Second, as I said, wherever there is deviation, we actually covered how to implement this in your regular languages. What is the best pattern to implement this functionality in your regular language? So like for every session like this was followed with language specific sessions for how do you do this in your language. And that is very necessary. Same for init reverse, just for reinforcing, this is an iterative version of init. So this init is recursive. You're using the return value of the next call, and you're doing a cons operator on that. So you're waiting for what the called function returns. So this is actually a recursive process as well. This is the iterative equivalent of it. And then we introduced list comprehension. So I don't think it's fitting, but yeah. Is everyone aware of list comprehensions? Anyone who doesn't know list comprehensions? Okay, a few people. Talk to me outside. Next, we introduced data and like structured data. So this is to force people back into the old C struct kind of days. Even with Python dicts or Ruby hashes, by the way, Ruby hash is like a completely different monster compared to a Python dict, right? But just think C structs. The difference between a Python dict and a C struct is you have to decide the structure at compile time, whereas a Python dict will just accept anything you put in it. There's no enforcement of structure. And that is something that I found was really lacking or missing in program designs. So this data basically is defining a new struct type, which says that it's just a struct of two floats, okay? And we just took a point, considered as a vector, and did the standard distance formula and vector sum, vector magnitude, etc. As you see, again, this is deconstruction being applied on the left side. The thing that we introduce here is creating new values from existing data instead of mutating the current data objects. In Haskell, basically, what if I wanted to change the x coordinate of this particular point? How do you do that in Haskell? There's no mutation. Well, you can't do it in Haskell. The solution is to create a new data value with the changed value as you want. Okay? And at this point, you really have to go into things like immutable data and efficiency of cloning, and explain that there's no real cloning and all that, and that this does not apply to their languages. Okay, otherwise you'll get people cloning objects all over the place. Yeah. So initially I did not insist on writing the type signatures. Later on, as you'll see, I did insist on writing type signatures. But it is very important at every single step of the way to open your REPL and ask them, what is the type of this? Like, even if you do a simple A plus B, what is the type of A? What is the type of B? What is the type of A plus B? What is the type of plus? Right? It is very important to ask them and continue to quiz them on the types of all of these. When I'm talking from the point of view of teaching someone, but if you're interested in self-learning, basically apply it to yourself recursively. So trust me, people are not going to get this right at the first attempt, and they're going to run into the type checker every single step of the way. So even if they don't want to, they are going to be forced to confront the type checker. So here I'm just showing code that works. Getting to this point takes a large amount of time, especially for someone new to Haskell. So here you introduce the notion that instead of mutating object, you just create a new object from whatever parts you need, and it works because it's really efficient. But it's important to also cover in their specific language when to clone, when not to clone, and what is efficient in their language and what is not. Right? But at least they see the possibility of writing real world programs by not having any mutation. And we typically finish with like a largest sample, largest example. So this particular example is about, so this is a simulation example, you know, as stateful as it can get. So what this does is, let's say you have a circle of n people. The first person, let's call them, index them 0 to 999 or 0 to n minus 1. If it's 1,000, it's 999. The zeroth person has a sword. He kills the person next to him, passes on the sword to the next alive person. The next alive person also kills the person next to him and passes the sword on. And this continues till there's only one person left. So what is the index of the person who survives at the end? Right? A very stateful operation. It's a simulation exercise. And I usually use this for as an introductory example in other languages. But I ended it, the course with my Haskell course with this. Again, some interesting things over here. So Zoom, interesting. I don't know whether it will work. Let me try this. Oh, it works. Wow. So the interesting thing over here is, so Venkat had mentioned about the composition composing functions together, and it doesn't really work well because it goes right to left. So in Gofer, I've actually modified this and replaced it with the comma operator, which actually does left to right. So think of it like a Unix pipe. So this entire thing is a function to which if you pass an argument, it will first go through at, the result will go to kill, the result will go to replace. So it's easier to reason about function composition like Unix pipes rather than the other way around. And that was another advantage of Gofer, that I could quickly add in a function like that, which behaved the other way instead. Can I zoom out? So what I want to show next is some examples of, so what I did was I took some old code, and after this entire course, I gave it to one of the guys to just refactor. Hey, this is your code. Now you have gone through this course. Now please refactor it for me using whatever you have learned. You see there is lots of stuff that is common, repeated patterns you can see. But it's not that straightforward because here you have something called as register dropdown, which takes dropdown. 1-2 minutes? Okay, we have to cut down. I just wanted to show the last one. This is what it ended up with after refactoring. The interesting part for me is this part. Okay? All right. So if you are going to try it, it's just last few words. It takes a lot of effort. It takes a lot of investment. You will often face resistance if you want to do it in your organization. There'll always be the question of, what if we invest so much to train our people and they leave? Right? My standard response to that is, what if you don't invest in training your people and they stay? Right? So thank you for your time.